Welcome to Take the Lead Radio with Dr. Diane Hamilton, where she interviews some of the most successful leaders, entrepreneurs, authors, speakers, and other individuals who will inspire you to take the lead in your career and personal life. And now, here is Dr. Diane Hamilton.
Welcome to Take the Lead Radio. This is Dr. Diane Hamilton, and I'm so glad you joined us today because we have Heidi Spirgi and Scott Peltin here. Heidi is the Chief Strategy and Marketing Officer of Cornerstone, and Scott is the Chief Performance and Co-Founder at Tignum. So we're going to have some interesting performance and strategy discussions today. I think we might even get into curiosity, perception, and a lot more. So stay tuned, and we'll be back right after this.
Are you interested in finding out more about how HR professionals or leadership consultants can become certified to give the groundbreaking new Curiosity Code Index assessment? The certification program will provide the ability to administer the assessment at reduced rates. Participants will learn how to interpret the results of the CCI, as well as how to deliver an innovation plan workshop designed to improve curiosity, engagement, innovation, and productivity. To find out more, go to curiositycode.com.
I am here with Heidi Spirgi, who is the Chief Strategy and Marketing Officer of Cornerstone. She came to Cornerstone with over 20 years of experience in HR technology industry. She previously funded a consulting firm, Knowledge Infusion, which was acquired by Aperio. She's worked on the product side, the practitioner side, the consulting side, and now is leading the strategy and marketing divisions of Cornerstone. It's so nice to have you here, Heidi.
It's great to be here, Diane. Thanks for having me.
Well, I was looking forward to this. I mean, we have a mutual friend in Ira Wolf, so I think anybody who knows Ira has got to be okay. And so I was looking forward to meeting you.
And likewise.
Yeah, Ira's the best.
He is great.
We have a lot of things that you and I both are passionate about, some of the same things. So I thought this is going to be fun to find out a little background on you, because I want to find out how you got to this HR technology path.
Yeah, so it's interesting and somewhat unexpected path. I grew up in Cleveland, Ohio, the daughter of lifelong VP of sales, and I always said, I will never go into business. Business is boring. It lacks creativity and innovation and all the things that I'm passionate about. I thought I was going to go into politics and studied political science, and then I found a passion for art, so I got my master's in art history. And was an art curator at the beginning of my career, wound up working for the second largest collector of contemporary art in North America, Peter Norton. Some of you may know the name Peter Norton. He was the inventor and founder of Norton Computing, that invented Norton Antivirus, and many other really groundbreaking technologies back in the 80s. He ended up selling his business to Symantec and made a lot of money and started becoming an art collector. So he asked me to set up a database for him. And I was like, data what? What's a database and why would I do that? Because that has nothing to do with my interests. So long story short, through that, I actually discovered how creative technology can be and how it's really, fast forward many, many years later, we realize that technology creates the world that we know it. And so to me, it's a highly innovative and highly creative function. And to me, what that sparked in that moment, actually, I wound up working as a business analyst at Swiss Bank Corporation over in Zurich for my first real technology job, and then at PeopleSoft for several years. And what I learned and discovered, which is what continues to motivate me to this day, is how really fascinating and exciting and, for me, inspirational it is to think about the intersection between people and the human experience and technology. And technology does inform our world in so many ways, and we have to be really thoughtful, and I believe we need the best brains on that and applied in the right way on that problem, because it does, when applied well, it can improve human existence. So that's been my through thread. So I'm not a technologist, I'm not an engineer, but I'm passionate about how can we improve the world at large and through technology, and my specific area being and I believe if we can improve the lives of people at work, we can actually change the world for the good. So that's really been what kind of has kept me in this space, despite having initially no interest in business and no interest in technology, and a lot of passion for changing the world through politics or the creative, artistic experience.
Well, that's an interesting background, especially some major companies. And I would love to have had some of your jobs. It sounds really fascinating. My husband's from Cleveland. He's from Wycliffe. I don't know. Just a
second. Oh, really? Oh, funny. Yeah, I know. Well,
I think it's really, you've brought up a couple things. I worked with a lot of consultants and leaders and different people to develop curiosity in people. And part of it, I found what stops people from being curious is that, you know, they have fear, they make assumptions, you know, tell themselves certain things, but also technology, they can over and underutilize it. And they also have an impact from their environment, everybody really with whom they've ever come into contact. And as I looked at curiosity, I, of course, researched mindset. Carol Dweck's research was very important, but you talk about fostering a beginner's mindset with your team, and I want to know what you mean by that.
Yeah, so before I came to Cornerstone, I took a 2-year sabbatical just to really prioritize other things in my life other than my work world. And I really got into yoga during that period and discovered this concept of a beginner's mindset. And what a beginner's mindset is it's originally a Zen Buddhist term, and it refers to having an attitude of openness and eagerness and lack of preconceptions when studying a subject. So it's really approaching every subject or every encounter in life as a beginner would, with a complete open mind, lack of preconceived notions, a lack of bringing an expert's mindset to the table, which means I'm bringing all of my years of experience, all of my knowledge to bear on this problem, which in many cases can close the window of innovation and openness. Mm-hmm. So it's really important as people in this world and organizations think about building their culture, which is, you know, how do you actually value openness and a lack of preconceived notion and a lack of expert mindset versus the opposite? So I think it's pretty exciting if you really begin to delve into it. And I know I think a lot of mistakes that we make in the business world and at the world at large are based on, even if it's an underlying mindset, we've always done it this way. Right. Or that's how things work here. Or that's how things work. Or that's a best practice. And one of my pet peeves is the term best practice. Because there really is no best practice. There's really emerging practices. Organizations should always be learning. People should always be learning. So new practices should always be emerging. Because the world isn't standing still. So what was maybe best yesterday is certainly not going to be best tomorrow. So in order to define tomorrow, because the world around us is changing, we need to think about tomorrow, whether that tomorrow is how does our organization, our team, or even a process function or operate. We need to come to that big challenge and that question with a beginner's mindset, with a really open mind, the way a beginner or a child approaches the world. I mean, you see, curiosity is, you know, peaks in early childhood, and we see it start to plummet throughout life, and that is because this beginner's mindset starts to become closed off, and people start to rely too much on their existent knowledge and their past experience versus really coming to every question and every opportunity and situation with complete openness and listening and learning and listening and learning. You know, the old adage, two ears, one mouth. Yeah. It is absolutely essential to the beginner's mindset.
Well, I think that, you bring up so many things that everybody's trying to do to unlock innovation. And if you don't recognize, it's almost like you're coming to play golf and you've learned this bad golf swing and you have to start all over again and learn all these different things. It's almost easier to come into an industry and not know anything because you do have that beginner's mindset, but a lot of us have this baggage, this way of looking at things. And I know I encourage a lot of people when I do my talks and training to look outside of their cubicle, to look outside of their industry, you know, and their silos and their industries even. But do you see a lot of examples of companies going and looking at outside industries for ideas, or do they kind of pretty much go by the book of what's been invented in status quo thinking?
Yeah, it's a great question. I think that is one of the biggest mistakes that the companies make in terms of looking at looking at competition and benchmarking their performance and benchmarking all attributes of their organization, is that they tend to look too much at peers. Similarly, I think we make a mistake where we hire too often, particularly at the leadership and executive level, industry insiders. And I'll just speak candidly from the world of HR technology. I think we have so much to learn about technology in the workplace from other industries. And how do we serve our employees and our people at work differently? And we have so much to learn from how other industries operate. I'll just give you a couple of examples. One of the things at Cornerstone that we're working on and looking at is the way people learn in the world today, not just at work, but probably just as more importantly outside of work, is very, very different from how people learned in the past. And the challenge for corporate learning functions today is, how do you actually enable employees to always be learning? And how do you enable the intersection between work and learning on a continuous basis, that it's not something separate from work, but it's part of work? And so therefore, how do you get the right learning in front of the right people at the right time? Well, guess what? That's a problem that's been solved already by content marketing. So if you look at what marketing has done, and how anyone who's used Instagram or Facebook and the power of marketing today and identifying based on patterns and attributes that we understand about the individual person, personalizing in the case of marketing, ads, and how do we get the right ads to the right people? Well, marketing is well ahead of corporate America in terms of how do we get the right learning and content to people. And so that's just an example of where I think looking at other industries, there's so much to be learned and gained from that. In fact, we just hired a new chief product officer, and we deliberately made the decision to hire someone without the domain expertise of human capital management software. Yeah. But to look, and he actually comes from Adobe and Marketo, and I think that's just, there's so much good to be gained there. One of the things that I like to talk about when I am trying to encourage innovation in the various companies I've worked for is, if you think about what happened in Florence during the Renaissance and just the explosion of innovation that we saw, it wasn't random, it wasn't coincidental, it wasn't by accident. It was actually a very, very deliberately cultivated environment that gave yield to the Renaissance. So the Medicis were a banking family in Florence, and they very deliberately funded creators from a whole wide variety of disciplines: artists, sculptors, poets, scientists, astronomers, philosophers, financiers, painters, they brought people from all around Europe together, and they cultivated an extraordinary environment of cognitive diversity, people with very different sets of experience and backgrounds and talents, and brought them together and created a conversation and created a community, which gave birth to just an absolute explosion of innovation. And I think that companies have so much to learn from that, because by bringing together a bunch of like-minded people who have the same set of experiences, the same set of knowledge, the same set of interests and talents and passions, what they're going to get is more of the same. You're not going to, you know, get that breakthrough of thinking. So to me, that is a way of cultivating the beginner's mindset, because when you when you intersect a sculptor and an astronomist and you sit them down, and I'd love to just picture in Florence these conversations that occurred.
Yeah.
You can just almost viscerally feel the new ideas that result from it, and it's how innovation happens. It's not from expertise. It's from the intersection of diverse minds, diverse backgrounds, combined with a lack of preconception.
You bring up so many interesting points. The marketing point that you made, I had created a brand publishing course for Forbes before I left at the Forbes School of Business, and it was such a challenge back in that time for them to figure out how to get this message across at scale and make it really personalized. And so I have to agree that marketing has done a lot to get into that mindset of how you reach your customer, how you reach your even your employees in this different way. And as we're creating these teams. I used to train back in the day. I had written my dissertation on emotional intelligence, and I got certified in all these different personality assessments. And one of them I used to give was the Myers-Briggs, which people don't really give now so much. But when we put these teams together, if you had everybody who was all the same on a team, it was really dull. And whatever they would create would be just like boring, right? You'd give them Legos and they'd build a boring house. And then you put a team together where everybody's diverse. You'd give them Legos, they'd build you a castle and a moat and all these cool things, right? So you get this diversity, but with that diversity and more creative output, you get much more conflict. And so that's what I think is really important to learn about curiosity, to learn about the other person, to develop that empathy, to understand people from their perspective. And so in my further research into perception, I saw it was kind of a combination of IQ, EQ, CQ for cultural quotient, and CQ for curiosity quotient together. But I hear a lot about AQ as well, which is the adaptability quotient. And I've had people on my show, a great company called AQAI out of London, and different people who do this research about adaptability. I saw that you do some stuff with adaptability, and why do you think adaptability is going to be so important?
So it's funny, because I actually started to really get interested in the topic of adaptability before the pandemic, mm-hmm. and before 2020. And I think the easiest way to describe why it's important is just to look at what has happened to businesses and to people, humans at work, in 2020. The amount of personal, professional, and organizational pivot that we have all gone through in the last 8 to 9 months is really astounding. And there was a recent survey done of CHROs, and they asked the question, what is the number one most important skill set that you believe your organization needs to focus on, hire for, cultivate, et cetera, in 2020 and beyond? And the answer was tolerance for ambiguity. And tolerance for ambiguity has everything to do with adaptability. People who are able to adapt are able to tolerate an ambiguous world. And 2020 is extraordinarily ambiguous. And the reality is, I expect that ambiguity to continue, because guess what? It's not just the coronavirus that is yielding a tremendous amount of ambiguity, but it's politics, it's climate change, it's the speed of which technology is driving change in every industry and in every segment. And so I think that being able to adapt to and be comfortable in the unknown, and adapt. Sometimes I get the question of what's the difference between, I talk about AQ and adaptability quotient versus EQ or emotional quotient. And the way that I think about it is that EQ, or emotional mastery, really helps people, and is very important. It will never go away, but it helps people react to change, deal with change. But it's still a reactive stance to change versus a proactive stance to change. And AQ enables people, or allows people, to truly not just react to change and tolerate change, but it gives them the ability to drive change and become change agents and to embrace change and to encounter change with confidence and resilience and to actually see change as an opportunity, not as something to navigate through. It's a very different mindset about change. And so organizational adaptiveness is, I believe, one of the most important things that leaders need to seek and build and cultivate, because organizational adaptiveness is going to require not only the people, but all of the structures, all of the processes, programs, systems, all of the things that we have built as defining our infrastructure of our company needs to be able to be very adaptive to the environment that we live in, and to pivot not just to react to the environment, but to be part of that change. Because, you know, I always say to our customers, you know, change is the only constant, and either change is going to happen to you, or you're going to be part of the change and you're going to drive that change. And the businesses that thrive and sustain, and people who thrive and thrive in their work environment, are people who are going to be driving the change and not be victims of it.
Yeah, it's such an important skill. I've talked to the people who've created these adaptability quotient scales, and part of what they had incorporated was curiosity in some of that. And so I've talked to a lot of people about this, about what comes first. You know, if curiosity comes first before motivation and drive and innovation and engagement, and where does it play a part in adaptability? But I really think you have to question things. You have to have that desire to know, you know, how to react and want to react. What part do you think curiosity plays in adaptability?
Yeah, I think it is. It's foundational. In order to adapt your business, to adapt yourself, to adapt your role, to adapt your skill set, you have to be willing to grow, to stretch, to change, to learn. And the kind of foundation to doing those things is curiosity. It's really, really hard to make yourself grow or learn or change if you're not curious about what's on the other side. So curiosity, I do believe, is a foundational human mindset or capability that enables the process that people need to go through, which is grow, stretch, change, which, let's face it, can be uncomfortable. But if you're curious about what's on the other side and you're excited by the opportunity to learn something different, to learn something new or do something different, then that process, even though there will always be some discomfort in change, it will actually be a positive experience because you're actually curious about what's on the other side. So I completely agree. I think it's essential. And I think one of the questions is what can organizations do to help their people cultivate curiosity? And what can organizations do to help their people adapt in a way that they feel safe and secure? And so some of the things that I work on with my teams and that I try to bring into the companies that I work with is this whole focus on creating a sense of trust, allowing for a sense and notion of risk-taking, celebrating failure, ensuring that teams, people, my team, any team, understands that adaptability and it requires being highly iterative and trying new things you've never done before. So I use a term, OSM, oh shit moment. I hope this is okay to use that term on the air. But it's been kind of core to how I manage my teams. And I actually ask people to proactively cultivate and identify and create OSMs so that they are, it's that moment where you're, you know, you've never done something before. You're not sure if it's going to work. It's a grand experiment. It's naturally going to create anywhere from a mild sense of anxiety to a high level of fear. And you kind of jump off the cliff and you say, here we go. We're going to give it a go. And the only way people and organizations can encourage people to take that kind of risk, those kinds of risks, is by not only tolerating failure, but also celebrating failure. So one of the rituals I have with my teams is we actually call out failures. We call out and celebrate OSM, some work, some don't, and what do you learn, and how did that feel? And what did you take from it? I mean, obviously there's many kinds of failure. Some are not to be celebrated, but some are absolutely to be celebrated. We did a, as you know, all of the live events in 2020 have been canceled. We, as a company, acquired Saba Software, our number one competitor in the space, earlier in the year, and we threw our first global and our first virtual users conference, and we had over 20,000 people register.
Wow.
Prior attendance maxed out between the combined orgs at around 5,000, I'd say. So it was very big for what we had previously experienced. And we were seeing all kinds of failures in the industry, and like the technology fails, or you know, people couldn't register, people couldn't get in. And we said, and then a lot of companies started canceling their users conferences. And we said, and I went to our executive team and I said, I think it's the right thing to do. And we're covering all the bases, but it could still fail. And if it fails, it doesn't mean the team has failed. It simply means that we tried something new, a tremendous experiment, and there's some risk associated with that. But you can't have a breakthrough moment without tolerating risk. And fortunately, it worked out extremely well. And we learned so much and got such positive feedback from our customers. And in fact, that we actually think it will become a permanent fixture because it was such a positive event for our customers. We got such tremendous feedback. And that was a grand experiment. And I don't think, I think the culture of accepting risk, accepting failure, and then ensuring that your people trust that you have their back when we do fail is essential to creating the environment in which people are willing to adapt. We could have just opted out and not adapted to our new world because of the risks associated with it.
Yeah, I think that's a great example. I wrote about something very similar in my latest book on perception about, you know, what one person went into a sales call with another person and how they both came out with completely different viewpoints of if it was a success or a failure. And, you know, the one who saw it as a success was because of everything they've learned from everything that happened in
yeah.
Other would might see as a failure. So that's exactly how I see it too. So it's a great story. And this has been really interesting. I knew Ira always had such interesting people to suggest. So I was really looking forward to having you on the show. I just wanted to see if you wanted to share how people could follow you and learn more about what you're working on, what you're doing. I know you have a podcast and something else that, you know, anything else you want to share?
Sure. So I do have a podcast. It's called HR Labs, available on all the podcast channels. So please check that out. You can follow me on Twitter at H Spirgi, most on LinkedIn. And if you're interested in following Cornerstone to find out what we're up to, we have a tremendous blog called Rework, or you can follow us on Twitter at Cornerstone Inc. Or at our website on cornerstonedemandondemand.com. Probably more importantly, of interest to the full audience, is that we also have a website, which I would encourage you to visit, called Cornerstone Cares, and that can be reached at cares.csod.com. It's a free learning platform available to the greater public. We've launched it in March in response to the pandemic. And since then, we have launched free online learning courses on stress management, COVID-19 safety, interviewing techniques, so an offering for people whose careers or work have been impacted by the pandemic. We also launched an unconscious bias. There's free unconscious bias training out there, which we launched in response to the social unrest that we saw sweep across the world over the summer. So that's a site that we're going to continue to keep open and available to the public because we believe there's just so much value in learning.
That's awesome.
To address some of our world's biggest problems.
Oh, well, hey, that's great. I knew you were doing amazing things, and it was really fun to chat because we both like some of the same areas of interest. I think some of this behavioral knowledge is so important. So thank you so much for being on the show.
Well, likewise, thank you, Diane, for having me. It was so much fun, and I look forward to a future chat.
Yes, I do too. And we will be back right after this message. Curiosity is a critical and direct link to improving motivation and communication-based issues that challenge organizations. By improving workers' curiosity, you can enhance employee engagement, emotional intelligence, innovation, productivity, and many other byproducts that come with that intrinsic but underutilized attribute. To find out more about how to improve curiosity, please go to curiositycode.com. I am here with Scott Peltin, who is the Chief Performance Officer and co-founder at Tignum. Tignum is the world leader in helping business professionals rule their impact. I am fortunate that I got to speak recently at Novartis, as did Scott, so I'm very excited to have you here. So welcome, Scott.
Thank you. It's great to be here with you.
Oh, well, I was looking at your background. It's pretty impressive. And I know you have a book that I'm really interested to get into. It's the title is Sink, Float, or Swim. And you're a highly rated speaker and high performance expert. So we're going to have plenty to talk about. Before we go into, all of that you're doing now, I was hoping if I could get a background on you, that what got you interested in performance and just what is your kind of, what led up to this?
Yeah, well, my background is a little bit odd in the sense that I spent 25 years in the fire service and I retired from the Phoenix Fire Department as a division chief. So I always had my hands and my mind into this concept of how can human beings show up at their best, even under the highest stress, and even when the cost of not being a high performer can be devastating. And I went to University of Maryland and my initial degree was in kinesiology. And so even then I was looking at biomechanics and human movement and how we could be better athletes. And then I kind of took a little side trip for 25 years into the fire service, but I got my master's while I was there and continued to work on especially performance mindset and how important the mindset is to how we perform. And so when I retired, I kind of moved that over to a different population, but the problems and the concept of what is going on in the human brain and body when we're going from meeting to meeting, when we're trying to be our best day in and day out, when then we want to walk in the door at the end of the day and have the biggest impact on those we love, that just fascinates me, and that's what Tignum was built all around.
Well, that's really interesting. I have some friends in the fire department. I don't know, Scott Wilkins was a friend of ours. He worked here in the Phoenix. I think he was in Mesa Fire Department. I know we've had some interesting stories. Were you part of when the Prescott fire and all that went on?
That was after I retired. Okay. I actually remember I was out of the country traveling with clients and remember seeing that and thinking, oh, my God, how devastating.
Awful.
I mean, to have a fire that loses one firefighter, which happened to me several times during my time in the fire service, but that's already devastating. To have a fire that you lose 19 people.
Wow.
Catastrophic.
Yeah, it is. It's really sad. We hike up to the top of Sun Butte and they have a nice little memorial thing up there in Prescott. And it's just a really... it's a very inspiring what the fire service can do. People give up their lives, as you said, and so you learned a lot about resilience, obviously, working in what you were in before, and I could see why that would be a focus for you. I was looking at some of your clients. I worked for AstraZeneca for 20 years, and I saw you have a lot of pharmaceutical companies on here. Like AstraZeneca, GSK, Novartis. I mean, you're working with IBM, AOL, Intel. I was looking, it's a who's who. So how did you get such big clients? How did you reach that level of success?
Yeah, well, it's funny. The other funny part about that is we're 100% word of mouth company. So we have no marketing. We have no sales team. But what happened was we got an opportunity to work with Sandy Ogg, and he was the chief HR officer of Unilever at the time.
Ah.
And they were facing one of the biggest HR transformations still in history. And he had three or four people on his team that looked like they were going to not make it, which was kind of the impetus for the book Sink, Float, or Swim, which they were sinkers.
Right.
And yet they had this huge, huge talent and huge potential, but as human beings, they just weren't doing the things that would help them show up at their best. And so Sandy took a chance and hired us. And as it turns out, Sandy's a very influential guy. And so when people start talking about and people start seeing, like, what did your team do that changed them so profoundly then they ask, and then they ask, and then you know how the business world is. People, you work with someone in Novartis, and then they go to GSK or
right.
AstraZeneca, or start a biotech firm like Denali that wants to cure Alzheimer's, and before you know it, you're a little bit here and there. And so that's been the funnest journey of all, is just to see where we can go and the people we've gotten to work with.
Well, you have a co-author, is it Yogi Ripple? How do you say that?
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Now, Yogi Ripple, yeah.
Is he work with you as well, or did you write this book in addition to, or on the outside of that?
No, so we work hand in hand. We always joke we're brothers from a different mother, because he's from Germany, and I'm from Washington, D.C., but lived in Phoenix for, you know, a long time now, over 38 years. And we actually met, our paths crossed at Athletes Performance, that trains world-class athletes. And he had this idea for Tignum. It was actually his baby, his idea, because his father had just passed away from cancer. And in our meeting, you know, I shared with him that my father also died at 53, not from cancer, but died young. Mm-hmm. And I started sharing with him my passion for human performance, and he was sharing his passion for helping top executives not wait till it's too late to invest in themselves. And together, his background is actually in marketing and communication. So when you take someone like my background, I'm a scientist, you know, exercise physiology, performance psychology, right. And then you connect that with the emotional side of how you communicate
yeah.
and share ideas, it actually was like an amazing come together. And very unlikely, because our paths only crossed for 3 days, but it shows that maybe there's nothing that's not predestined. I don't know.
Yeah. Well, it sounds like you guys are very much interested in what I'm interested in, and I think performance and just the behavioral aspect at business is really challenging. I still teach for a lot of different universities, and we talk about culture and how it trickles down, and if you have a certain culture at the top, it's very hard to change. When you work with these companies, I imagine they come to you because the top has bought into the need for cultural change. Have you ever tried to kind of hit it in the middle, and can you do that? Can you change the culture throughout the company without the buy-in from the top?
Well, the cool thing that we do is we often work with a leader in their team. And so it is always better when it's supported from the top. And I do have some examples of times where the leadership didn't 100% support it, and it was very frustrating, and it could only go so far. But because each team has its own culture, and that's one of the things you learn in the fire service, you know, if you're on engine 21 versus engine 3, the culture can be, although you're kind of in the same bounds, the unique culture of that setting is unique, and the leadership is unique. And so when you work with a leader who really wants their team to be what we would call sustainable high impactors, so showing up at their best and really making the best impact, then you can create a culture even within that team. And that's kind of a cool thing to do.
Well, okay, so you talk about or write about sink, float, or swim, and you talked about sinkers. Okay, so you break people into three categories, I mean, of the sinkers, the floaters, and the swimmers, and how do you know which one you are?
Yeah, so it's funny. In the book, we give some examples of what are the things that a swimmer does and a floater does and mm-hmm. a sinker does, but, you know, the idea is not to categorize people, because that can also be a little demoralizing in a
right.
sense. And the idea is that everyone can move from the left being a sinker to the right being a swimmer. And I mean, actually, the name came from when we were looking at all of our data during the last recession in 2008, and we realized that on one side there were these people that were really struggling, many were burning out. But on the other side, there were these people that got better and better even under high stress, got stronger. And they actually had specific strategies they were using, many of the ones that we were teaching, some that we learned from them what they were doing. And we started benchmarking that against what is the high performing special operations guys do in the military, and what do athletes do? And, you know, in many ways, the idea of human performance in business is about 30 years behind these other places. And so that's what we started to realize. And then we realized there was this huge group in the middle, which was really the highest opportunity, which was they were just trying to keep their head above water, make it through today, make it through this week, make it through next month. And they didn't realize that they could be better. And we started to show them that that was a product of the choices they made day in and day out. And if they just became more aware of those choices, they could move to become a swimmer.
You know, it's really tied into some of the research that I did with Curiosity, what you talk about. And I know you spoke at Novartis's Curiosity Month, as did I. And I'm curious what your topic was of how it tied into curiosity, first of all.
Yeah, so it's funny, you know, we look number one at mindset as a built by mindset skills.
Right.
And curiosity is one mindset skill, which means it can be grown. It right. can be practiced.
Right.
And so what I try to do is get people to be curious about themselves. Like, to get really simple, I'm curious about what I do before I go to bed that maximizes the quality of my sleep.
Yeah.
I'm curious about how movement can activate my brain and actually not only make me smarter, but make me more creative. I'm curious at how, when I know a moment is coming, like let's say I have a critical one-on-one meeting, how when I add curiosity to that, I make myself more curious about that person, more curious about what success would look like, suddenly my relationship changes. And since we know that all human performance in teams is built on relationships and relationships are built by moments, then my curiosity in that moment is a big impact differentiator. And so that's kind of what we did, you know, even getting people curious about food, because, you know, so much what you hear about nutrition is about deprivation. Don't eat that. Don't eat then. Right. Don't eat that much. And you want people, no. Get curious about what foods actually wake you up, how the enjoyment of food, you know, the partnership with food, the relationship with food changes the way you eat. And all of a sudden, it's a totally different dance.
Yeah. You know, that is really interesting because my next book that I co-authored with Dr. Maya Zelhich is based on perception, and curiosity plays a big role in perception in the workplace of how, well, that would be your perception of the food of being an enemy or something you can work with kind of thing. But if you look at perception, it's kind of a combination of EQ, IQ, CQ for cultural quotient, but also CQ for curiosity quotient. And as you ask these questions in the workplace, I mean, the teams are much more able to work together. And you do a lot with energy, resilience, stamina, mental agility, fulfillment, growth. And I was looking at some of the stuff that your clients, that you maximize. So do you deal with training them in the areas of perception or curiosity, or is that just a byproduct of the other stuff you do?
No, so those would be mindset skills. So kind of the four areas we really focus on is mm-hmm. mindset, nutrition, movement, and recovery, and how you integrate those four things. And the more your performance is a peak performance, you know, one where you can really make a big impact, the more it's mindset driven.
Mm-hmm.
But that mindset has to be supported by, you know, the food you eat, the recovery that you get, and the movement that you do. So a lot of our stuff is built around how do you build a high performance mindset. And you know that one of the big skills in building a high performance mindset is reframing.
Mm-hmm.
And reframing is an exercise of building a new perspective, right? Being able to mm-hmm. put something, whether it's a problem, whether it's a story, whether it's your self-talk, even if it's your self-image, you know, put it in the middle of the table and walk around it and give yourself a different perspective. Look at it from different angles. And that's often an exercise we'll do with people, even around their bias, you know,
mm-hmm.
because you can't change your perspective if you don't understand your bias. And one of the problems we see today, I'm sure you see also, is people's fatigue levels are high. And especially their emotional fatigue, and fatigue forces the brain to double down on our biases, because bias is an efficiency tool. And so if I don't need to think different, that will take energy. Why would I spend energy that I don't have? I'm just going to double down on my bias. And we see that everywhere in society and leadership, which is sad right now.
Mm-hmm.
So coming back to reframing and making sure that I have the energy to challenge my bias and walk around and look at these things from different perspectives is huge.
You know, it really is. And you've used the word mindset a few times. And I in my research and curiosity, I, of course, used Carol Dweck's work on mindset, which was really instrumental of having, a growth versus a fixed mindset. And as you're talking about this, what came to mind, you mentioned self-talk. The four things I found that keep people from being curious are fear, assumptions, which is really that self-talk, what we are saying in our minds, right? Technology and environment are the four factors. And with the self-talk, I don't think people recognize how much, well, you talk about bias, and we hear a lot about confirmation bias and how we, it's just something that we're having a hard time getting around right now. Do you make any suggestions about, in general, because a lot of what we read is that Facebook or, you know, social media or whatever they're in, their news station, or we tend to keep listening to the same things that confirm our bias. But at work, that's a little different scenario. So do you ask them to work on this outside of work as well, or is this just a within work kind of focus?
Yeah. So all the strategies that we teach apply equally away from work at work. So that's mm-hmm. one of the very important things that we really push is mm-hmm. impact is impact, mm-hmm. right? So this whole concept of overcoming what we already think, one of the ways that we do that is we first try to get people to realize that none of us can outperform our own self-image. Therefore, own your self-image, create it, make it the way you want it. Don't have a default self-image from your parents, from media, from social media, from your friends, from all these other places. And so if you don't allow others to define who you are, already you're ahead of the game.
Right.
The second piece of that is we are very, very big in what we call intention setting. How do I want to be perceived? What do I want you to know? How do I want you to feel? Well, imagine if I'm going into a situation and I want to be perceived, like you mentioned, Carol, I want to be perceived with a growth mindset, a person who's open and willing to challenge my bias. What do I want you to know? That although I may have opinions, I'm open to learn from you and I'm curious about what you have to teach me. And how do I want you to feel? I want you to feel trusted, listened to, heard, loved, whatever that is, right? And when I add those intentions, I prime my brain to step outside of what I think I already know. And that's a couple techniques that we found have been really, really pragmatic, but really powerful.
You know, and I think it's a really important, I wrote my dissertation on emotional intelligence. And so empathy is a huge part of emotional intelligence. And I think the ability to be curious and ask people more about themselves, not only do you get a perspective unlike your own, but you're able to build that empathy to appreciate their perception and their perspective, where I don't think, you know, a lot of people want to try and find out what other people are thinking or get, they don't even think to go there. How do you get people to think to even go there?
Yeah, so one perspective that we really try to get people to think about is your perspective on competition. Mm-hmm. If your perspective is competition is war, then already there has to be a winner and a loser. So I have to be right, you have to be wrong. And what you find from the research, even in athletes, is that can actually be very destructive. It leads to cheating. It leads to shortcuts. It shortens your career. It leads to high blood pressure and other cardiovascular problems. But if we can reframe that perspective to competition as partnership, so I need you as my competitor to help me be my best. You inspire me. You know, we're in this journey together. Even if I want to win and you want to win, it's okay because I appreciate you as a competitor. And you see that in like Roger Federer and Rafael Nadal in tennis. You know, you're seeing right. that more and more. And I think we really get people to look first at with that perspective. How do you see competition? And to realize that when you see competition as partnership, everything becomes more fun. You become more curious. You're a better collaborator. You build better relationships. You're healthier. You know, you burn out less. So when you see that and you see a Roger Federer who can have such a long, successful career, and you compare that to some other tennis players before who had very short careers because they had huge anger issues, you say, okay, there's something really interesting there.
Yeah, you know, that is interesting. I'm thinking of Jimmy Connors or some of the others
yeah.
who were getting a little angry at some of the stuff, but that they still were successful to some extent. Is any of it just a game of a show, or did you find that a lot of the athletes really did have anger issues?
Well, so there's such a thing as controlled aggression, right? Mm-hmm. Learning to use aggression as an impetus to build energy mm-hmm. or focus, because we do know that stress is the greatest human performance enhancement tool there is. Mm-hmm. So it has a point, but it's not sustainable.
Yeah.
And that's the problem. So if your entire perspective is one way, then it's not just something you're using for a short moment to get a burst of energy. It actually is ruling you. It's changing your self-image. And so that's kind of the difference. You know, I like for my athletes, I like for, even for my executives, sometimes I get angry at myself because I didn't prepare like I should have. And I use that to fuel me to get better, to push myself out of my comfort zone into this, you know, like you talk about potential. I want to unleash my human potential. I can only do that if sometimes I'm disappointed. So it's another piece of it. Like, I think we've been a little bit poisoned to think that the only emotions that I should feel as a human being are the good ones. I should be happy and fulfilled and loved. And we forget that, you know, sometimes sadness and despair and anxiety, like those emotions teach me a lot. Embrace those also. And when you embrace them and I don't fear them, then my perspective on them is a positive perspective, even though it's not it doesn't feel good. And that's okay.
Yeah, and I think a lot of companies are dealing with a lot of people who are fearing the situation right now with COVID and their job security. And I mean, you're here in Arizona as I am. Now we can't travel, and you're not very much, at least. How has that impacted your job and the people with whom you you work? You know, and just is there a new focus that you had to dwell on in your training programs because of that?
Yeah, well, of course we went, like you, probably all virtual, which mm-hmm.
is weird.
But it's cool also because, it created some opportunities that I noticed that we could actually make a bigger impact in some areas. One thing I noticed, and I don't know if you've experienced this, it takes way more energy as the presenter because you don't get the same energy back. So it's much harder to multiply my energy and get my energy multiplied back. But, you know, one of the things that we do is because we study this area so much and we're coaching so many high performers and executives in different arenas is that you see, you know, you get to share what your observation is. And one of those observations is that people are tired, but it's a different type of tired because we're not traveling. So we don't have jet lag. We're not sleeping in different beds. And so if you really look at people, their sleep quantity has gone up probably about 45 minutes more a night. Most people added, but then their fatigue level went up and they couldn't figure it out. We've seen one thing is that sleep quality went down. And why would that happen? Well, one reason is the fatigue that they're feeling is both cognitive fatigue, so brain fog, and emotional fatigue. And when we have emotional fatigue, we tend to have more ruminating thoughts. We tend to be more sympathetically dominant, so our fight or flight is engaged. And therefore, we don't have the quality of sleep. So helping people realize that what you're feeling, by the way, is normal. And by the way, the strategies that you use for physical recovery are quite different than emotional recovery. So let's get the right strategies for the right type of fatigue.
Do you deal with meditation in that realm, or is it more eating, exercise? Do you get into that kind of depth?
Oh, we get into very, very, a lot of depth in all these areas. So meditation would be one, but again, most people think so. Commonly, and this helped us understand this better, is people would say something like, you know, Scott, 5 years ago after working with you guys, I started exercising more and that gave me way more energy. And now I find that number one, I'm not as excited to exercise. And number two, I don't feel that same energy all day. Why is that? Or they would say, 8 years ago, I started meditating and I meditate every morning for 20 minutes. But now I find that I'm frazzled still in the day and I still feel overwhelmed. And why isn't meditation working anymore? And I would tell them, we would tell them, both of those are still very viable, great tools. But what it's telling you is things are changing and you need more tools and you need the right tool at the right time. So even I'll have a lot of my clients now do a 5-minute meditation in the middle of the day as a cognitive reset. We'll build in, you know, we'll change movement from just being high intensity to also being a recovery tool or using some novel movements where you have balance and three-dimensional movements as a way to activate your brain when you've been sitting in front of a computer the whole time. And we'll build in emotional recovery things like planning for fun and making sure that you're talking to someone and reflecting on what you did well and keeping a journal about what you learned, because learning shows that the energy I'm putting into something is paying me back. And it's easy to forget that when you're overwhelmed.
It definitely is. And I think those are all really important points in a time that we really need a lot of this advice. And I think you do some amazing things. It's nice to know you're here in Arizona. I don't meet a lot of people on my show from here. So I was really looking forward to having you on. And I think a lot of people would like to find out more about Tignum and you. And is there some kind of way they could follow you?
Yeah. So if you go to, you know, www.tignum.com, T-I-G-N-U-M.com, you'll see, number one, our Tignum Thoughts, which are our blogs, which are always a kind of experience that we had with a client, thinking that if this was one person's challenge, it's probably many people's challenge. So kind of similar to what you do. You want to share how we can help people. You can also find our book there. You can find it on Amazon. But if you go to our website, you can see how to reach out to us. And, you know, we always love the conversations. We're not on any of the blogcasts. Our blogs are kind of inside our universe right now. We have a digital platform called Tignum X, X meaning the multiplier. And so everything's not always easily available, but you can always find us on our website.
Oh, that's awesome. So it's so nice of you to do this, Scott. I was really looking forward to it. And very interesting background on everything that you do, and great success with all those amazing clients. So thank you for sharing it.
Thank you, Diane. And it's great meeting you. And I hope one day we can meet actually face to face, since we live in the same area.
Wouldn't that be nice?
Yeah.
If I ever leave my house again. We will be back right after this message.
Do you know someone who might benefit from taking the Curiosity Code Index assessment? The CCI is the first and only assessment that determines the factors that inhibit curiosity. It's simple. If you recommend the assessment to someone else, you can receive 20% of the purchase price that they pay when they take the CCI through the link provided by you. To obtain the link and become an affiliate, please go to drdianehamilton.com/affiliate.
Well, I'd really like to thank both Heidi and Scott for being my guests today. We get so many great guests on the show. If you've missed any past episodes, you can find them at drdianehamilton.com. If you go to the blog, you can actually read them as well. And of course, you can find us wherever podcasts air and on all the radio stations listed on our site. But I really enjoy having behavioral experts, and some of the topics we get into on the show are so fascinating. So if you've missed any past episodes, check them out. And I hope you enjoyed today's guests, and I hope you join us for the next episode of Take the Lead Radio. You've been listening to Take the Lead with Dr. Diane Hamilton on C-Suite Radio.